In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about complications of diabetes mellitus. Now, the complications of diabetes mellitus are basically of two types. One is acute complication and another is chronic complication. Chronic complications. Okay. In case of acute complications of diabetes mellitus, we have mainly two conditions. That is, the first one is diabetic ketoacidosis. And the second one is hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. So these two are acute complications. The chronic complications are the vascular related complications, that is vascular complications. So, in case of vascular complications, mainly macroangiopathy or microangiopathy can occur. Then there are certain complications in eye, complications of eye. So, for example, in case of diabetes mellitus, we may have early cataract or retinopathy. So, these two are the most prominent complications in the eye. Then we have certain diabetic neuropathy in which nerves are affected. Then we have diabetic nephropathy in this kidneys are affected. Then we have certain pregnancy related complication. If mother is diabetic, then the child may have certain complications. So those complications are the pregnancy related complications. So these are the various acute and chronic complications of diabetes mellitus. So in this video, we are not just going to discuss about what are the complications. We are also going to discuss that what are the biochemical basis of this complication, why this complication occurs in the diabetes mellitus. So let's start with the first acute complication, that is diabetic ketoacidosis. So the first acute complication that we need to discuss is the diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, before we understand about this diabetic ketoacidosis, we need to understand that what is ketoacidosis. So for that, we have to first understand that what are the keto acids. So in general term, these keto acids, they are known by ketone bodies. They are known as ketone bodies. Okay. So what are these ketone bodies? In our body, in human, there are mainly three ketone bodies are there. One is acetone, then we have acetoacetate, and then we have beta hydroxybutyrate. So these three ketone bodies are there. So why these ketone bodies, they are also known as keto acids? The reason is this acetoacetate and beta hydroxybutyrate, these two are the strong acids. So because of that strong acid characteristic, these ketone bodies are also known as keto acids. So now we know what are the ketone bodies. So now let's understand how these ketone bodies are synthesized. So ketone bodies are basically synthesized from acetyl coenzyme A. This acetyl coenzyme A is the raw material for this ketone body. There are certain intermediate steps are there, and by that these ketone bodies are synthesized. Okay, but normally this pathway is very, very minor. Why? Because whatever acetyl coenzyme A is there in our body, the most part of this acetyl coenzyme A, it binds with oxaloacetate. So oxaloacetate and acetyl coenzyme A both binds with each other and forms the citrate. And once citrate is formed, this citrate undergoes series of reaction, and it generates the oxaloacetate. Once again, oxaloacetate is regenerated. Now, what is this cycle? This cycle is a TCA cycle, right? So this acetyl coenzyme A, it has two options. It can either go into the TCA cycle or it may go into the ketone body synthesis. But in normal condition, the most of the acetyl coenzyme A is diverted, or you can say it is normally going into this TCA cycle. So that's why I'm making this arrow thick. Okay. So this is a thick arrow. That means I want to show over here that most of the acetyl coenzyme A is going into the TCA cycle, and only a minor part of this acetyl CoA is going for the synthesis of ketone body. This is the normal scene. Okay, now why it is so? Why normally this thing occur? The reason is this oxaloacetate. This oxaloacetate is basically a raw material for the glucose synthesis. Okay, it can give rise to synthesis of glucose by the process known as gluconeogenesis. Okay. This insulin normally inhibits this gluconeogenesis process. So what happens? This oxaloacetate accumulates in our body. Okay, this is the normal process. It is completely normal. Insulin normally inhibits this gluconeogenesis. So what will happen? More and more oxaloacetate is available. Why? Because it is now not able to get converted to the glucose. So this higher amount of the oxaloacetate will attract this acetyl coenzyme A, and it will convert it into the citrate. Okay, so that's why most of the acetyl coenzyme A is taking part in this TCA cycle, and it is not going to towards this direction, towards the ketone body synthesis. I hope this part is clear. Now, from where does this acetyl coenzyme A comes? From where does this acetyl coenzyme A is coming? So there are three main sources. One is from the lipid, the other source is carbohydrate, or it can come from the protein. So all three major source of food, lipid, carbohydrate or protein, ultimately they give rise to acetyl coenzyme A. Normally what happens, the lipid when gives rise to acetyl CoA, that process is known as lipolysis. There is a lipolysis, is very important process by which lipid is broken down. But this process, this lipolysis is actually inhibited, normally inhibited by the insulin. So here you can see that insulin is doing a very high level of regulatory work. The first thing, it inhibits lipolysis, so less amount of acetyl coenzyme A is there. And second, insulin also inhibits this gluconeogenesis, so more amount of oxaloacetate is there. So ultimately what will happen, whatever acetyl coenzyme A is there, it immediately binds with the oxaloacetate and convert it into the citrate. So only less amount of acetyl coenzyme A can go for the ketone body synthesis. So by this, one thing is very clear. What is that? That normally ketone body synthesis is occur in very less amount. Okay. So because of that, normally the ketone body level, in blood is less than 1 milligram per deciliter. This is the normal level, okay, when everything is under control. And in case of urine, see, all these ketone bodies are water soluble. These are the water soluble ketone bodies are water soluble. So we know that whenever anything is water soluble, it immediately excreted into the urine. Okay, so in case of urine, these ketone bodies are present. They are in very trace amount. Why in trace amount? Because in blood, there is very low concentration. Okay. So trace amount of ketone bodies are present in the urine. That is in normal condition. But generally we do one test, that is Rothera's test. This Rothera test can identify, can detect the ketone body. But normally in the urine, this ketone body are in such a low concentration that Rothera's test is negative. Okay. What does this Rothera's test does? This Rothera's test identifies ketone body in the urine. Okay. So this is, these two things are in normal condition. Now let's try to understand. What is diabetic ketoacidosis? See, in case of type 1 diabetes mellitus, what happens? In case of type 1 diabetes mellitus, there is insulin deficiency. deficiency. So if insulin is deficient, what will happen? The first thing, this inhibition will goes away. So what will happen? More and more lipid will now undergo lipolysis and gives rise to acetyl coenzyme A. So can we say that more and more amount of acetyl CoA is there in our body? Why? Because insulin is not there, so lipolysis is not inhibited, so more and more lipid is broken down to acetyl coenzyme A. So this is the first hit. The second place is over here. As insulin is not there, insulin is absent, what will happen? This gluconeogenesis is now not inhibited. So what will happen? More and more oxaloacetate is diverted for this glucose synthesis. So what will happen? Oxaloacetate concentration is decreased. Now see, you have higher concentration of acetyl-CoA and lower concentration of oxaloacetate. So what will happen? This acetyl-coenzyme A now cannot, bind with oxaloacetate. Why? Because its concentration is very, very low. So now this acetyl-CoA, only one pathway is left, that is for the synthesis of ketone bodies. So now I am making this arrow thick, and there is a stoppage of this pathway. So more and more acetyl-CoA gives rise to synthesis of ketone bodies. So concentration of ketone bodies increases. So now this normal condition, what happens to this normal condition? Okay. So now in case of type 1 diabetes mellitus, what will happen? There is increased blood level of ketone body. Normally, the concentration of ketone body was less than 1 milligram per deciliter. But now, blood ketone body level is increased. That is known as ketonemia. This is the first condition. Second thing, in urine also, see, earlier I told you that ketone bodies are water soluble. So, they can excrete into the urine. Now, in the blood, there is more ketone body. So, obviously, in the urine also, there will be more ketone body. So, now, Rothera's test will be positive. So, Rothera test is positive, or you can say ketonuria. Whenever ketone bodies is there in urine, it is known as ketonuria. Okay. There is one unique thing about the acetone. This acetone is not metabolized and it is volatile substance. It is a volatile substance. So what will happen? Whenever blood passes through the lung, so along with the carbon dioxide, this acetone, as by being a volatile, it is also exhaled. And this acetone has a fruity smell. So what will happen? The smell of acetone will be there in the breath. So smell of acetone in breathing. So these are the some of the typical features of the diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay. So there is ketonemia and ketonuria and the smell of acetone in the breath. This everything collectively known as ketosis. Ketosis. Right? Now, so what if ketosis occurred? Are there any bad effect of this ketosis? So answer is yes. This ketosis has very severe effect on our body. So now let's try to understand that what are these bad effects because of this ketosis. See, earlier I had told you that acetoacetate and beta hydroxybutyrate, these two are ketone bodies which are strong acids, right? So whenever strong acids, what does it mean? It means more and more increase H plus concentration, and whenever increase H plus concentration, there is decrease in the pH. So either increase H plus concentration or decrease in the pH, that is known as acidosis. Okay, that is known as acidosis. So there is one condition is developed, that is acidosis, and because of this, the name is there, that diabetic ketoacidosis. This is because of diabetes, then ketone body, and then because of that, there is acidosis. So now name is justified, right? Diabetic ketoacidosis. Now let's see what will happen further because of this acidosis. So in our body, there is one very good bicarbonate buffer system. And bicarbonate buffer system is maintained by this equation, that whenever H plus is there in our blood, it binds with bicarbonate ion HCO3 minus. then it is in the equilibrium of the H2CO3. Okay, H plus and HCO3 minus both are in equilibrium with this H2CO3, and this H2CO3 is further in the equilibrium with the H2O and carbon dioxide and the carbon dioxide. So this is the equilibrium reaction. This is catalyzed by the carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Okay, so this is a normal reaction. But now let's try to understand what will happen if more and more H plus concentration is there. That means acidosis is there. So what will happen? There is here more and more H plus concentration. So now this equilibrium is disturbed. What will happen? As H plus concentration is increased, this equation will shift towards the right side. Okay, so what will happen? More and more H2CO3 is there. So more and more H2CO3, again it will shift this equilibrium to the right side. So more and more carbon dioxide is generated, right? More and more carbon dioxide once generated, what will happen? This carbon dioxide, it stimulates respiratory center in our brain. It stimulates respiratory center in our brain. So what will happen? Now respiratory centers are stimulated. So what will happen? There is a hyperventilation. What is hyperventilation? Hyperventilation is increased respiratory rate. See, there is not only this hyperventilation, but there is also increased depth of respiration. Okay, now let's try to understand that what is this. So suppose this is a normal respiration. This is inspiration, this is expiration, then inspiration, and this is expiration. Let's consider this two cycle of inspiration and expiration. Okay, this is a normal thing. In the green color, this is the normal thing. But whenever these respiratory centers are stimulated because of the carbon dioxide, there will be an increased depth of inspiration, increased depth of expiration, increased depth of inspiration. So depth of inspiration and expiration both are increased, and simultaneously respiratory rate is also increased. So let's try to understand it. See, in the green color, up to this point only two cycles of inspiration and expirations are there, but in this red color there are four cycles. So now respiratory rate is also increased. Such type of breathing, it is known as Kuschmals breathing. Now in addition to this Kuschmals breathing, what happens? There is a more and more H plus concentration. So suppose this is some of the normal cell of human body. This is the nucleus, and there are so many H plus ions in the extracellular fluid. So many H plus ions are there. So what will happen? Because of the concentration gradient, this H plus will move inside the cell. So now H plus are moving inside the cell. So what will happen? The plus charge is shifting from extracellular fluid to the intracellular fluid. Now to maintain the charge neutrality, what will happen? The potassium ion will move outside the cell. See, the potassium ion will move outside the cell. So what will happen? In the extracellular fluid, there is an increased potassium concentration in the extracellular fluid. Okay, so see what things are happening in this case, that there is acidosis. And what kind of acidosis is there? It is metabolic acidosis. Why metabolic acidosis? Because this acetoacetate and beta hydroxybutyrate both are metabolic acid, and this acidosis, the reason for this acidosis is this metabolic acids. So what kind of acidosis? There is a metabolic acidosis. The second thing, there is a Kuschmals breathing. I told you the reason why Kuschmals breathing occur. There is an increased potassium concentration. I had also told you the reason for that also. Okay, so now let's move forward. Now the damage by these ketone acids doesn't stops over here. There are certain more things which can go wrong with this ketone acids. Okay, so there is a ketone urea. As I had earlier already told you. What is the meaning of ketone urea? Ketone urea is the ketone in urine. So now this ketone body, when they are present in the urine, they are osmotically active. They are osmotically active. Now, because of the osmotically active nature of these ketone bodies, there is osmotic diuresis. There is osmotic diuresis, right? And so there is a water loss. There is a water loss. Now, this ketone in the urine, they are not excreted as such, but they are excreted. They are excreted as a sodium salt. As a sodium salt. Now, what is the meaning of this? Its meaning, if suppose, for example, you take acetoacetate, this acetoacetate is not directly excreted, but this acetoacetate is excreted in ionic interaction with the sodium. So, it is a sodium acetoacetate which is excreted, not plain acetoacetate, right? So, here what will happen? Sodium is also lost. Sodium is also lost in urine. So, what it will have effect? So, because of water loss, there is a dehydration. There is a dehydration because of the water loss, and there is a low sodium concentration in the blood. Why? Because the sodium is being lost in the urine. And earlier we had seen that potassium ion in this plasma, in the extracellular fluid, is increased. So, see, there is a electrolyte and water imbalance, and these things are severe. So, if this thing remain untreated, it can lead to coma, and ultimately it can lead to death also. Okay. So, this was all about the diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay. Diabetic ketoacidosis, and we had seen in the diabetic ketoacidosis that there is ketonemia, then there is ketonuria, then the smell, fruity smell in the breath, then we had seen this Kussmaul's breathing, that is increased rate and depth of respiration, increased potassium concentration, then we had seen this acidosis, this is metabolic acidosis. Then we had also seen that there is a dehydration, there is a low sodium and high potassium, which may ultimately lead to coma and death. So, if someone asks you in which type of diabetes, mellitus, this diabetic ketoacidosis is common, our answer should be it's a type 1. It's a type 1 diabetic, type 1 diabetes mellitus, in which diabetic ketoacidosis is common, right? Now, let's talk about the type 2 diabetes mellitus. In type 2 diabetes mellitus, we know that insulin deficiency is not there. Rather, in case of type 2, what is there? Insulin resistance is there. What does it mean? It means, even though if insulin is present, this insulin will not able to work on its receptor, right? So, in case of type 2, there is mainly either insulin is normal or actually increased, okay? Insulin is rarely decreased in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus. So, what will happen in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus? Will this diabetic ketoacidosis will develop in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus when the insulin is normal and increased? What should be your answer? No. Actually, diabetic ketoacidosis is rare in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus. And now, the question arises, why it is not common? It is not common because we had seen in the pathophysiology that the central hormonal play is by the insulin. If insulin is normal, then these steps are not inhibited, and so acetyl-CoA is not diverted for the ketone body synthesis. So, in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, diabetic ketoacidosis is not common. In case of type 1 diabetes mellitus only, this diabetic ketoacidosis is common. Now, let's discuss about the second complication, that is hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. Now, this hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma, it is common in type 2 diabetes mellitus, in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now, when this will occur in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus? Whenever glucose concentration in the blood goes more than let's say 900 milligram per deciliter. So, this is very, very high concentration of glucose, right? So, whenever glucose concentration is too much high, what will happen? This glucose is actually osmotically active. So, there is increased osmolarity of extracellular fluid, increased osmolarity of extracellular fluid. Simultaneously, on the second side, what will happen? There will be a more glucose in the urine. So, see what will happen? This is the Bowman capsule and this is the renal tubule, right? These are the efferent arterioles and this is the efferent arterioles. So, what will happen if blood glucose concentration is very high? All the glucose will be filtered over here. So, there will be very high concentration of glucose over here. Now, this glucose is osmotically active. So, what will happen? More and more water is drawn over here, right? So, there is osmotic diuresis. There is osmotic diuresis. That means water is lost, okay? So, there is water depletion. There is a water depletion. Water depletion which leads to dehydration. It leads to dehydration. On the second side, because of the increased osmolarity of the extracellular fluid, what will happen? Suppose this is some neuronal cell. Okay, suppose this is a neuronal cell. This is the nucleus. So, what will happen if glucose is very high in this extracellular space? Now, again, this is osmotically active. So, what will happen? The water will be drawn towards the higher concentration of glucose. So, water is lost. Okay. So, there is a intracellular dehydration. Intracellular dehydration. And here the first or the most commonly affected cells are the neuron or the nerve cells. So, because of these, there might be a development of coma. And if this is untreated, it may lead to death. So, see the name of condition. It's a hyperosmolar. Why hyperosmolar? Because of this such a high concentration of glucose, there is very high osmolarity of the extracellular fluid. The second word is non-ketotic. See, here insulin is either normal or increased. And when insulin is normal or increased, there are no chance of development of ketone bodies, right? And the coma, that is because of the intracellular dehydration of the neuronal cell. So, this is about the biochemical basis of this second complication. So, in the next video, we will discuss about the chronic complications of the diabetes mellitus. If you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.